That is probably Sherry Jones already joined. Hey, Sherry. And that video is look okay over there. It looks. Let's see. Last thing is the Zoom meeting. Hey, it's using the right microphone. They'd even have audio if they join us. Cool. Okay. All right, and look at that. We've got Sherry and Heather. Hey, hi there.
Hey, Sherry. Hey, Heather.
All right, so welcome to what I believe is the 7th episode of The Mindful Activist. I'm the host of this podcast, and we're broadcasting live on Facebook and on YouTube. So I'm Matt Reddy. I am the founder of the Global Consensus Project, the creator of the HiveOne.net activist platform, social media platform. What else? And I am also an elected politician. I'm a hospital commissioner here in East Jefferson County, Washington. Today I am very happy to have a good friend of mine, Jale. I've never said your last name. What's your name?
Alma E.
Alma E.
Yes.
So, a good friend of mine who I never call by her last name. And so, before I ask you to introduce yourself, I was going to introduce you in a way I've never introduced a guest before, which is with a little video introduction, which they'll see a little bit of on our giant screen here. So this is a little video from the day I met Jale, which was several years ago, back in during the Occupy movement. And let's see how well this works. You know, I might have to I'm not sure it's fair to them to really be showing, but if you can see this is. No? It doesn't look like they can see it very well. But we have Jale in a police outfit, and you'll at least get to hear some of it.
Are we gonna make it?
Are you kidding me? I got kids at home. I'm gonna have to find more childcare.
That sucks. How's your shoulder?
My shoulder is killing me.
Well, when we take him down, let me do the heavy lifting. Just back me up, will you,
Sean? All right, I'll go. Sean, take him down.
When we edit this together, we're gonna we'll show it.
Okay, we're doing a direct action.
Come on up, join us. Come over here.
Hey, come join us. Come
All right, so when this is spliced together, it will actually show the video on the screen. You'll be able to see it well. But this is a performance of the Poetic Justice Theater Ensemble, which you were a participant that day in that performance, and we'll come back to that. That was when I first noticed Jale existed in this universe. But then, after that, oh, it's sort of a shame this video doesn't show up. Maybe I'll just show the pictures. So, No, they don't really see that here. But there's a big, if you could see this, there is a big tent in front of Bank of America and a bunch of people here outside protesting.
That was actually a really great action.
It was.
For those who don't know Port Townsend, it's a pretty small town on the Olympic Peninsula, and there was a really big turnout to basically occupy Bank of America and the Poetic Justice Theater Ensemble, which I'm a member and trainer of, a program of the Mandala Center for Change, which I'm the co-director. We showed up to do a public performance as known as a Forum Theater Project, which essentially invited people on the street who were watching to come step in and replace the character they saw struggling. And the little play that we did, which was just about 5 minutes long, was essentially a play about police brutality. Some protesters peacefully singing and linked arm, and these two police officers, myself being one of them, kind of going overboard, quickly resorting to violence and arrest, specifically of the man of color who was there, even though all the other people were white. He was doing no different than anyone else. Even as I'm talking about it, this was a couple of years ago,
but
it feels like even more relevant now than before. Not that the number of, especially black men, but black people in general, has not, the number of black people who are incarcerated and the level of police brutality that they are met with on a day-to-day basis has been happening for a long, long time. But now mainstream media has caught on and amplified the awareness, which is different now than it was even just a few years ago when we did this action. So I was really proud and honored to meet you because you were one of the key organizers in that event. And so it was sort of the first union of grassroots organizers meeting, and I consider myself a theater activist. And so that was my world kind of colliding with yours. You had been doing a lot of work with the Occupy movement here locally. So it was a really nice exchange and a great turnout for a small town. Do you remember the numbers? I felt like there was well over 100 people there.
Probably. Through the course of the 4 hours.
And, right.
It was very surprising to me. And it was sort of a magical moment because after the performance, we did this march, and I was going to show that video, but since it's not coming through, I'll splice it in. But we marched with this giant tent and with bagpipes and drums, and I think the whole Poetic Justice Theater Ensemble joined, and we marched through the main street of Port Townsend and through a bank drive-through and brought it back to Bank of America and put the giant tent right in front of the front door. And then then people went and laid down in the drive-through. But during the march, which was like really one of the most inspirational moments of my life, we didn't know what was gonna happen. We didn't know if we'd even get, if it'd be like three of us marching into the streets, it turned out to be a huge crowd. But so I'm carrying the tent and I like have my phone out and I'm taking pictures, and I turn around and I took that picture. And this, I'm like flipping through my pictures afterwards and I'm like,
I would like a copy of this picture for those of you who can't see it.
Yeah.
It's me in a faux police uniform with a very smug grin on my face.
Yes.
I chose to keep the police uniform on because I felt kind of like a badass. I'm exercising my power there. I had my teenager's faux leather jacket on, and as a theater artist, we had the police hats. And I liked actually messing with people's perception that maybe there was a cop in the mask that was part of the action. Do you know what I mean? It was kind of pushing the edge just a little bit, and I loved that.
Yeah.
I loved it. I loved the idea that people could... I might have been misrepresenting, but not really, because I wasn't acting like a cop. I was just walking with the hat and the coat on, so no official anything, but It was great.
I don't think you actually broke the law impersonating an officer.
I did not. But but visually, you know, if a passerby was walking and they saw me, I think they would, without really looking closely, it did look like there was a police officer moving with the action and holding a sign and chanting and like really participating. And even just the idea of, you know, what that might imply to others was enough for me to keep it up.
Yeah, it was quite a day. And that was the day that I met Jalay, although, you know, it wasn't until it sort of like, I sort of got to know some of your work. I've seen you perform or interact many times with the Poetic Justice Theater Ensemble, mm-hmm. which does these incredible cutting edge activist theater, interactive mm-hmm. activist theater events, and which is often giving audience members opportunities to become part of these scenes, which are often basically, I mean, the group tries to come up with the most intense, you know, relevant, controversial type of scenes and subject matter that we could, as a society, possibly be wrestling with, and challenges the audience to come and interact. And I've seen you be a part of it. I've seen you get up and participate, and I've facilitated groups with you and helped with a process. So. One of the most impressive people I know.
I'm very humbled.
So, and so is there, before we get into some other subjects or deeper into these subjects, is there anything else you'd like to say about introducing yourself to the audience?
Sure. So, first of all, thank you for inviting me into this conversation and participating in this very multimedia way. It's really cool. This feels like technology at its best, you know, to create forums for exchange and dialogue, and that's really at the center of all my work. So is connection and exchange and sharing stories and the power of narrative, especially as it relates to social movements. So I could talk more about that in a moment, but by way of introduction, I would say my name is Jalay, and I'm an Iranian-American Jewish woman who is a theater activist and a mother and the co-director with my partner, Mark Weinblatt, of the Mandala Center for Change. One of our programs includes the Poetic Justice Theater Ensemble, which you've been referring to, which is unique in its ability to do what's called applied theater. And our techniques focus specifically on theater of the oppressed and playback theater, which are under the umbrella of applied theater but operate very differently, where theater of the oppressed is very focused on solution-oriented in its most popular format, which is forum theater, which is what we've been referring to here with this action. And playback theater, which is way more focused on building community through the sharing of stories and seeing those stories reflected and growing and connecting through the reflection of personal stories, not specifically focused on moving towards solutions. And what makes us unique in this work is that we combine them, which is not happening in any significant way that I know of. These bodies of work are practiced around the world. And in fact, Mark and I are teachers and facilitators to train others to do this. Mark especially is world-renowned in training in Theater of the Oppressed, and we host an annual training here in Port Townsend, now 24 years strong. So a number of international community come here to train in that methodology specifically. And we've started to tack on like a day-long intro to playback because I lead and teach. I come from a playback theater practitioner, trainer background, ritual theater artist. So that's a little bit about that world. I have two teenage sons, stepsons, 15 and 17, and one of my own, Darius, who's 3. and they are profound teachers and are profound motivators in all of my work as an activist. So when I lose sight, I just kind of come back to my kids and all the kids that they're connected to say, okay, now I remember why I'm doing this and what it's all for. So I don't just say I'm a mom flippantly. It's not like I'm a mom and I'm really proud of that, or I'm a mom and I'm, you know, stressed out and frazzled. Those definitely come with the territory, but it's actually parenting conscious children who have a social consciousness, especially young men, but women too. And so far, who knows who these children will become, you know? Having them be good allies and strong advocates, to work as an ally to marginalized populations and have a sense of the world outside of their own little American bubble. These are important things to me, and they are a guide and a Geiger counter for me in terms of my personal work and my work in the world. So that's a big piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is where I'm like, oh, you opened a couple like interesting threads.
Yes.
And now I have to choose which one to chase down.
Yes. And let me just say props to anyone out there who is a parent, and props to all the aunties and uncles and grandparents, because I do believe it takes a village. So I see us all in the picture, just naming my own piece in that introduction. Okay, which thread?
Well, okay, let's go with the youth, young people.
Let's do
power
it.
Thread. Because that really... that really resonates with me. I feel like this is just my impression of the way our country has sort of been since the 60s, but it seems like during the 60s, at least college age young people were more engaged in the massive activism that was going on around the Vietnam War. And I feel like that something has really changed in our country in about the level of engagement of youth and high school and college age. I mean, there's massive disengagement of all demographics, but it seems like when you were talking about how important it was to you that your children
they're engaged in the world around them.
Yeah. And allies.
Yeah.
That was what really drew me, because it's like I feel like the youth of our country are so incredibly powerful. Mm-hmm. If they knew how, they just don't know how powerful they are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, and so I really appreciate the work you and Mark do in sort of really engaging youth and
mm-hmm.
young people. I mean, you just did a big
youth empowerment project.
Yeah, big youth empowerment project.
Using legislative theater,
mm-hmm.
which is a different type than what I was talking about before. It's all in the vein of applied theater. Legislative
yeah.
theater would fall in the umbrella of theater of the oppressed, and with youth specifically, it was it's policy making, legislative theater. It essentially invites into the audience the decision makers, the policy makers in that community related to the topic that's being explored, to witness and engage in different ways, so that at the end of the evening there is actually a voting that happen with the audience members to generate proposals and vote on proposals to actually make a change with the topic being explored. In that instance, the Youth Empowerment Project was specifically exploring schools and the education system, which we could probably spend the whole time talking about the failure of schools in this country, and the disservice it does to our young people. And so that was a really powerful and potent time. Mark and I are also very active in the community. He is a teacher at Jefferson Community School. We've set up rites of passage programs for both of the older boys. A lot of mentoring, you know, just really trying to keep the pulse on what's needed and what's missing and how we can help fill the gap based on our time, willingness, and skill to share and offer. Although I did want to respond to what you were saying, because to me there were two things that were coming up to me. One was, it's kind of like, where do you put your attention? So one thing I've become profoundly aware of is just the children who are being born now. It is a next level of who's coming in. And this isn't like the full mainstream picture. This is like a percentage, a portion of children who are coming in with these amazing capacities for compassion, for empathy, for learning, for knowledge, for this like deep inherent wisdom that they're just being born into the world with. And sure, one might argue, all kids are that way, but I'm talking about like next level. And people put words to this, these kinds of kids, and I don't know about all of the rhetoric. Some of it kind of tips on the new agey side, which I get a little wary of, but
do you not want to mention those words?
Well, I don't even know some of them. I mean, I've heard titles like, I'm trying to think of one now, Indigo
yes,
Children,
yes,
for example.
I knew I'd heard one of these.
Crystal Kids, you know, this like, and I think it's referring to a consciousness.
Mm.
So if you're able to ride that new age line with your, you know, social justice lens in check to say, you know, where is the truth here? How does that relate to what I'm doing and the work in my community? Anyways, I think for me, even just bringing it up, for me, what it means is that I'm working to see that piece in every young person that I interact with. And like investigating, like, where is that gift? And I don't know, I'm not specifically a youth worker. I wouldn't call myself a youth worker, youth activist, or anything like that. But it's like, without the children, then for me, I lose a huge driving force and center point in the work that I'm doing. Like, that's who it's for. I'm trying to create a better world for the next generation. In Indigenous wisdom, you're looking 7 generations out, right? And so, yeah. I forget the other thing that came up, but it's, yeah, there's a lot to be said on how we hold our youth and what more can be done. It just depends on what angle you're coming at it. Education system or,
yeah,
you know.
Well, I mean, I just see them as, what really rocked my world was when I went to Hong Kong, you know, and that the umbrella revolution that was going on there, it was youth led. I mean, it was so clear, you know. I would just go to these protest sites and you'd see some of these like high school kids, and they were, you know, blocking the streets, and they were sitting under these tents and in this one Mongkok district, very crowded district, and they're blocking these four-way, intersections, and it's only like high school age kids inside. Around it, you just see the older generation just standing at the edge, and I just took photos of them, and they just are staring at the kids. Some of them, I mean, the older they are, you know, it's like I like perceive even more levels of fear, you know. And then, but also you could see like, I mean, it's like this mix of fear and admiration, and because I mean they're messing with China.
You're bringing in the worldview, Hong Kong. I mean, it gets me thinking about Standing Rock and the youth who ran literally to DC, this thousands of miles, you know, and the number of youth currently at the Sacred Stone and Standing Rock camps who are infusing this historic movement with their leadership. It's not just their energy, but like the kids you're talking about in Hong Kong, they're putting themselves in positions that one might say in harm's way because of the clarity of passion. And when you look at Standing Rock and this movement that's happening currently in our country, you know, it is the in that cultural setting, the elders are listening to the youth, right? Which sounds a little different than your experience of the fear that you saw in some of the older people in Hong Kong. And to me, it's there's such a dis-ease and an unhealthy quality of mainstream America's way with the youth and elder relationship that is so severed, that it just is this huge, vast chasm to have to bridge, you know, and that takes a lot of work in and of itself. And so dialogue, you know, creating forums for us to come together and exchange ideas and supporting young leaders and, you know.
Yeah, because it's, if you are, I mean, the youth in the United States, I mean, if you look at the way the power machinery, it's like, it's almost like it's been structured to force, you know, keep youth power in this bubble.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's like, as
they're dangerous, man. They're powerful.
I mean, it's
they're powerful. The WIP government is freaking scared of them. That's a powerful force. If there's any young people out there, you better listen up, man. You're a powerful group, you know, and the government is scared of you because of how powerful you are. It's
it is
a structure. It is a power structure that says power over, and everything goes into that, which is brilliant for something like Forum Theater to show a slice of that and then ask people in the audience to get up and try solutions. So what do we do? What do we do? You know, and in a case like that, if we were doing a show, we might even say to the adults in the room, you're making guesses here because you're not a youth. You don't really know what the reality is, but go ahead and try if you've got an idea, you know, and then the dialogue continues. Is that what's the impact of that? And you know, that's an interesting part of the Theater of the Oppressed, also referred to as TO work, is after someone gets up and tries something to then have a couple moments to debrief it, analyze it,
you know,
really engages the critical thinking, which, you know, the other thing we haven't mentioned related to youth is, and I believe this is part of the power over structure, is media and technology.
Yeah.
You know, you can't have this conversation without including media and technology as the main sources of control. And unless you've got a really freaking empowered youth, you know, who can at least see that as they're engaging with it or make a choice not to engage with it or engage to a different degree than their peers, you know, they become one of the flock and are controlled by the media, the messages, all the conditioning. I mean, it's a sick and twisted world. And how can we remove ourselves from the paradigm that is created around us to create a more healthy and vibrant world for ourselves and the people around us?
Yeah.
That's happening all the time, all over the place. But if you aren't looking for it or connecting to that, it's so much easier to get hooked into all the dysfunction and crap that isn't working, and that'll just take you right down.
Yeah.
It's almost impossible to keep your heart light when you're really literally being drugged down with messages that say you're not enough, you're not good enough, you're not slim enough, you're not bulked out enough, you need to buy this, you need to buy that, you know, whatever, yeah, on and on and on. So
let's talk a little bit about the media, and you touched on that, because it's sort of, I mean, I see the media is one of the huge power arms of the machinery that keeps things the way they are, and it keeps power structured the way it is. You and this sort of ties to something you mentioned earlier about why violence against black men in particular may be becoming more to the forefront. I don't know that it's escalated. I think what's happened is media is becoming more and more free and democratic. So it's basically these these cameras, these cell phones everywhere that now can do like what we're doing now, a live video stream the moment something horrible is happening. This is a big chink. It's a big weakness in the armor of the power structures that hold everything in place. And you know, a place like China is well aware of the danger of, mm-hmm. of really free media. And when I was, again, when I was walking around Hong Kong, whenever something was happening, there were just like cell phones. It was just like nothing but cell phones wow. around. And they're just crossing their fingers, hoping the Chinese aren't gonna like kill them anyways. Because they, you know, still could do some pretty brutal things over there. And I was, you know, the whole time worried it could happen. But it's just like in Occupy, same thing happened in the US during Occupy mm-hmm. events. It was cell phones came out and people, you know, when something brutal was starting to happen, it said, people chant, the whole world is watching, mm-hmm. you know, with this, you know, hope that, and this sort of like belief that if we just open our eyes and see what is happening, you know, that will in itself, you know, cause, it won't stop what is happening necessarily, but it might, you know, feed the energy that needs to be fed to get us to change things.
I absolutely agree, and I think it really goes back to the narrative. You know, so we all, youth and elders and young people, older people, all of us have, I love the way you talk about it as a chink in the armor, you know, a vulnerable place. It's like that little belly of the dragon, that place where if you're gonna shoot an arrow, it better hit right there between the folds,
yeah.
you know, of those, of that armor that the dragon wears. And it's not just cell phones, you know, I agree that we do have more ability, although to a degree, you know, so I have heard plenty of stories of things getting shut down on Facebook. You know, you think that it's free until you get shut down. Plenty of people on YouTube who have a great time going until they get a little too much attention and they get shut down, right? So, you know, for what it's worth, you know, Big Brother hasn't disappeared, right? I mean, we are, again, it's this idea of freedom, and I think we have to exploit it. We must exploit it because we know that we will be the people who televise the revolution. It sure as hell is not going to be, you know, Fox News
yeah.
that does that. And yet, one reason I really love the Global Consensus Project is because it's working outside of a paradigm in a way. You're still part of the World Wide Web, and we're all vulnerable in that way. But things like Anonymous come up to me. Like, there are ways to manipulate the system. And so that's interesting to me. I'm not, personally, I haven't gone down that path. I didn't even know there was a dark web until my 17-year-old, you know, woke me up. If people don't know that this exists, it's very important if you have teenagers. And the dark web, I don't know much about it other than it's like where all of the dark stuff happens. The selling of drugs and people and pets and weapons and pornography and pretty much anything and everything. I can't really say anything more than that other than I didn't even know it existed until about a year or two ago. And so, anyways, I feel like it's yes to exploit the freedom on our behalf and also to recognize that we're still working within the paradigm that has been created for us. And so it's a both and,
yeah.
and I think we have to take it as far as we can and examine the risks that are involved when doing that. I think any passionate person who collects an audience and is either good at tech or has a team of tech to really be strong and get a message across at some point will be shut down, and so strategically needs to know how will they avert and keep going to find the next avenue to keep going and keep going. And so every time they're shut down, they find here is the next place to pop up.
Yeah.
And given that, there is a tremendous amount of resource being made available to all of us because of something as simple as a cell phone. You know, we know, for example, I'm just going to go back to Standing Rock because that's something I'm very connected to right now, to support and stand in solidarity with our Indigenous people and tribal nations of Turtle Island. We know that the dogs who were there for unmarked, unknown security didn't just show up to instill fear in the hearts, but actually did damage to people. That mace was in that kid's eye, and we saw it go in, and then we saw a picture of it. You know, we saw it happening in the moment. So I love that chant, "The whole world is watching," and I would love to resurrect that from the Occupy movement to be more of the norm. And I'd love to learn more and support more, especially with young people who are constantly, many of them, you know, empowered with a device to know how to use it and to know their rights.
Yeah.
You know, that's a key piece, is like, we actually do have, I don't know where the constitutional rights live, but they're, yeah, I mean, that information is out there and I'm like all about it.
Yeah.
Even though I don't know all about in this moment, I'm like totally supportive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, I love your focus on narrative. And on, you know, I had another person sort of like really talk to me about that. And there is such a power in the narrative. Who controls the narrative, the story of our country,
yeah,
of any event?
Yeah.
You know, and it's like this contest to control the narrative that gets into the mass media. But you're not going to win that game. We are not going to win the game of controlling the mass media narrative. Good to play that game. You gotta do that. But what, you know, the weakness is that we flood the airwaves, the internet, with the narrative that we want to tell. You know, it's like, you know, anyone that feels that their voice is not being heard could be heard. Could start a podcast. Could start a YouTube channel. Could go on to now. There's You Now is a video website that anyone could just go on and start a channel and start talking about
pretty
whatever
cool
they want to
stuff.
Talk about on Facebook Live. And
I think getting more resources shared of alternative media outlets is also really helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Someone just turned me on to the Unicorn Riot, which I didn't know existed until quite recently. It's a very radical outlet for news, and so far in my fact checking seems accurate. So I think sharing resources can be really helpful. I think my only devil's advocate in listening to you say what you just said is there's this really fine line around in terms of alternatives to narrative, of people putting out skewed narrative, right? Where I don't know what the motivation is, but I'm going to keep referring to Standing Rock because it contains so much of my focal point right now. Is on Facebook and social media, I believe Twitter as well, there were some pictures circulating from two music events. One was Woodstock many years ago, and the other is Burning Man. These pictures went out with trying to make it seem as though these were pictures from Standing Rock, of the camps, of the number of cars, of the number of people. And it totally legitimized it for whoever read it if they did not fact check it, right? And so I think, yes, we have to create a new narrative, and man, is it a piece of work to do that fact checking and not just believe. Like, it's fine to say I'm gonna be opposed to mainstream media and just focus on alternative media, but then there's an extra piece of work included on that, and that is the fact checking, and that is the resource checking, and that is the, just because it's alternative doesn't mean it's true. You know, who's putting this out and why? Who's backing them up? You know what I mean? I don't mean to get all what is it called when you get worried, suspicious, you know, or whatever, but I think you have to use caution. you know, for real, especially when it comes to social movements, there's always going to be an opposition. And so even if it looks like a positive message, it's good to refer to the gut and the intuitive mm-hmm. mind, and then do the little bit of extra work if it's something that's interesting to you. Is this true? Is this really true? Is anybody else saying it's true?
It's pretty good advice in general.
Yeah, in totally.
Life. I mean,
totally. But we don't all take that time. I don't take the time everything I read. I don't fact check. But if I care about it, then I'm going to do the extra rabbit hole to find, you know, where is this leading me?
Yeah. I mean, I find another just critical way of getting closer to a reasonable truth about anything is just the closest person you can get to that is close to the events. You know, it's like just speak to, I mean, if you want to know anything about what it's like to be a certain type of person in this country, talk to a person.
That person,
you
know? Right?
I mean, if it just opens up, you know, when you ask a person, tell me about your world, and you are so flooded with information and understanding that you don't get if you ask somebody else that, you know, is in your bubble already to tell me about what's going on over there in Standing Rock, or tell me about what it's like to be, you know, scared of the police in our country.
I definitely agree. I think that's what I love about theater, is it puts people in touch with each other. So that we're not making guesses about what does a marginalized person, and when I say that, that means anyone outside of a dominant social group, right? So whether you like it or not, you know, some systems might put you at the top, you know, white male, cis, right? Your gender matches your presentation in the world, cis male. And
what is cis?
CIS. So it's a terminology used to recognize, does your presentation, does the body suit that you have match the gender presentation? So do you present as a man? Do you follow the binary? Do you follow the cultural, I was going to say cultural norm, but you know, the cultural norms are changing. I went to a doctor appointment this morning and filled out, you know, male or female. And I told the lady, I said, wow, your form is really out of date. And she said, really? I said, yeah, the last form I filled out, there were at least four options on gender, you know, because there's just this huge movement around the whole attitudes and beliefs. I mean, the bathroom, you know, signage, just as one little piece that's in our, you know, ethers right now. Gender nonconformity, you know, and we have, that's a whole nother level of educating ourselves. But you want to know what it's like for someone who is trans or operating outside of the gender norm? You're sure as hell gonna make a lot of guesses until you actually go to someone and ask, what is your story? What's life like for you? You know, I just love storytelling for that reason. I love bringing people together in a forum where there's actors in service. You know, it's like this, it's that little bit of a bridge that happens when maybe there's a little social awkwardness to ask a certain question or whatever it is. You know, we're all in the room together and we have questions about each other, and we're all carrying these vast life experiences and wisdoms. And, you know, you get a prompt at the top of a show for two hours, you know, a facilitator puts out a prompt, someone answers it, and then that leads to another reflection, and someone says, oh, that makes me think of this in my life, and they share, and someone listens and says, oh, that I relate to this piece in their story, and it brings that story in, and it's just one after the other. And in playback theater, we call it the red thread, that thing that starts to connect us. It's the humanity, you know, it's like, none of us on the planet escape the need to be seen and heard. No one.
Does anyone escape the fear of being humiliated?
You know, man, I don't know about that. I mean, humiliation comes with the territory sometimes, but I don't know. I playback theater, it's not always deep and serious stuff. I mean, life has to have the happy, light, beautiful, memorable, enthusiastic, joy exuding out of all your pores moments to put into context the deep, dark despair. You know, we wouldn't be right without the full range. And even when we struggle in expressing the full range of our lives, that's still noteworthy. Yeah. I mean, the humiliation might be an internal thing. I don't know. Maybe it's, I can't say, but you know, I just believe you just gotta, I just accept folks wherever they're at. You know, it's not my job to judge. It's, we all have a journey that we're on. So,
well, maybe you can answer this question I've been wondering about all my life.
Whoa, no pressure.
Yeah. So whenever I do something that I find really humiliating and I'm usually laying in bed thinking about it over and over again, I tell myself, other people are laying in bed thinking about what they did that humiliates them. They're not, no one is sitting around with a notebook of my humiliating events and they're not like all replaying it. It's no, like, after, nobody cares.
You're
is
your
that
own
true?
Worst enemy.
Am I telling myself the truth? Nobody's paying attention. And am I ruining that by videotaping myself and sharing it with the world?
you know? We are our own worst enemies. I mean, that's a platitude that has some truth to it. I certainly am not tracking your most humiliating moments.
You're not? Okay.
And I'm also not spending time laying in bed thinking about the humiliating moments of my day. I do reflect on what could I have done differently, pretty much on all things of my life. Humiliation is that's a funny thing.
Embarrassment.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, I look back and I'm just like, ah, oh, did I really say that or do that? Yeah.
No. I've learned to be really gentle with myself, cause you know, I'm gonna mess up a lot, especially. I'm gonna mess up.
Yeah.
I mess up so many times every day, and I think it slows me down. Unless it's a really big mess up, you know, the little mess ups, I'm learning and affirming in myself how to, you know, take it in stride, to notice the learning, integrate, and keep moving, and not let that slow me down too much, because I don't feel like I have time. You know, I feel the urgency of the world around me, and I want to respond to it from a really grounded place. And so if I get too head trippy on myself, it takes me out of the process, and then I get kind of it's easy to spiral out for me.
Yeah.
You know, and so I think having good people close to me who can reflect back, who I can check in with, hey, I said this stupid thing, you know, can you give me some feedback on that? I mean, in a way, it's a great segue to talk about allyship, you know, because it's like, if I said something that was upsetting to, for example, a person of color, like, I want to check in on that. There's a little thing popping up on the screen.
That was a text message on my phone.
Okay. Yeah, I wanna reflect on my actions, my behaviors, my words. I wanna reflect on that, whether the person is gonna call me out or call me in. This different way of being, calling someone out in a public setting, hey, that's not okay, or calling in, you know, privately saying, hey, something happened, I need to process with you. If that never happened, but I have that little niggly, like, huh, I wonder, was that okay? You know, I have a practice of taking the initiative to circle back and double check with that person if I can, or at least someone else, to say, this wasn't feeling right, and can you give me some reflection? Because we need each other in that way. We can do so much reflecting for ourselves, and ultimately, I think we really... survival depends on each other to survive and thrive. You know, I like to focus on the thriving part, but the baseline of survival is putting myself in a circle of people who I trust, I admire, who I can learn from and also share my gifts with, who I create enough trust to be able to go and have these, like, I share a humiliation moment and actually get some honest feedback.
Yeah.
So, embarrassment, humiliation, jealousy, those are strong teachers. And so I want to slow down and reflect and integrate when those things circle around.
Yeah, I hear you. And you're reminding me, it's kind of the strategy I've been using with this podcast, mm-hmm. is I'm starting with a circle of allies and friends, you know, and sort of to build up, you know, my momentum and my confidence as I, you know,
expand
the conversation to eventually to include every voice I possibly could include in this conversation, this dialogue, and trying to figure out how do we make the world a better place. And a lot of those voices and a lot of those people are very challenging and draining for myself, at least sometimes, to
the people you don't know outside of your ally circle.
I'm a politician, so I interact with politicians. I mean, huge egos, not just on the board that I sit, but we interact with representatives and senators.
I love your honesty, Matt.
And they are, you know, and it's not, it is a weird thing interacting with people that believe they have power in the world and they are important and their opinion's important and they feel comfortable talking down to you or raising their voice to you, or just being incredibly rude in other ways. And that is just not what my community is like in this world. That is
Thank
not the
goodness.
Type of people that I interact with other than my dad. But, you know, it's like, something. That's the world of politics. Everyone's acting like my dad. But, we cruise through the time.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, are we at 5 past?
Five past two.
All right, well, I have to, can I ask you one more juicy question that I've asked
previous
guests?
Juicy question, yes. Here it comes, juicy question.
Juicy question. So it's about the power of violence and the power of violent communication or the threat of violence. Mm-hmm. So I'm just curious, how are you when you encounter violence, whether it's just anything from raising a voice to try to pressure you one way or the other, change your behavior, or I don't know, or anything beyond that. How do you react, or what are your tactics with that?
That is a juicy question, especially in the times we're living in right now, where there is such a threat of force and violence at all times when we step out to take action for what we believe in. So I'll respond in two ways. The first way is that if you had asked me this question 2 years ago, or two and a half years ago, a little differently. So one way I'm hearing this question is, you're asking how do I react to it? But I'm also thinking of this question of, would I resort to violence if it came down to it? Because a couple of years ago, I would have said yes. And I think it's interesting to self-disclose in this way, because it's been a real journey to recognize, and this is kind of going back to your question, the effect and impact of violence on me. Mostly indirect, but in some direct ways. I'm talking more about social movements and activism right now. I mean, I'm luckily not a domestic violence statistic, although I've experienced that as a child. I feel safe in my home and in my community, so I'm not facing violence on a daily basis, and I recognize the privilege that I have in that way. But I have traveled in places where it's been not safe to express myself or be passionate. Also, being a cis female, I'm in a very different category, putting myself in certain situations, than someone like yourself, who's a big tall guy. So I'm bringing in these other contexts to say these all play into my response to violence, including just my heritage, my ancestry. I know genocide in my ancestry. I know in my Iranian lineage what it means to be persecuted for your beliefs, your religious beliefs. You know, and so something exists in my DNA, in my molecular body, that says it's not safe to be too passionate or too vocal because of the threat of violence. So you have a text message that you want to check? No.
I just wanted to clear it. I don't know if it interferes with Facebook Live if I if that text. I don't think it does, actually.
Yeah. So these are important things to consider because my story and my heritage and my bodysuit are mine, but everybody has their own unique identity that informs a response to violence. So having said that, I've been on a real transformational journey the last couple of years, and which is maybe another podcast,
yeah.
Some other time, sure. But one of the threads has to do with nonviolence. And so armoring myself with a deeper commitment to nonviolence, and this is it's a toolkit, you know, it's not any one thing, it's lots of different things, including training, you know, of like what are my rights as an activist in a protest or an action. How do I pray by myself? How do I pray publicly? How do I surround myself in a prayerful way? And when I say pray, I essentially am referring to my ability to create a space in my heart and a space around me that calls for a good energy, a higher presence to be with me, to protect. And we all pray in our own way, and some of us atheists who don't pray at all, that is totally valid too, but I have found prayer as an action is extremely powerful. And so my commitment and remembering of both the old ancient ways of my Iranian and Jewish lineage that I mentioned that had the fear and the death and the violence in them also are held with tremendous wisdom of how to survive, how to thrive, how to protect, how to connect, how to build vibrant community. So those are things that I'm now more focused on in terms of my response to violence is essentially related to those tactics and strategies. I mean, there's probably a lot more to say about that, but it's actually violence in general is escalating in this country, gun violence specifically, you know? So I can't say that I don't feel worried when I go into big public spaces or that I avoid certain places because it doesn't feel safe to me to be at a stadium scene just because, you know. And so I try not to let, it's a very fine line for me, I try not to let the possibility of violence keep me from living a full life. And at the same time, for me personally, I feel like I need to be more aware of it and my response. It's moving with a warrior heart, really. It's having my defenses up, but not having those defenses limit what I can still take in, if that makes sense. It's not an armor that's impenetrable to love, to connection, to story, to friendship, that kind of stuff. But, you know, building an armor for myself, and then sharing that armor when I see someone who doesn't have it need it. And that's another piece of the work, the exercises that must happen for all of us to feel secure and confident in our ability to take good care of ourselves and then extend it. However we do that, whether it's prayerfulness or throwing your body over somebody or having a good lawyer on speed dial, you know, or whatever, maybe all of those and other things too. Yeah, so there's a lot to say about it, but I move very humbly through the world in a general way, and with a lot of compassion for those who are coming from a place to act violently. It's a tremendous amount of compassion, because I know no matter what anyone debates me, that person is struggling, and there is a place where an origin of the pain that I may never know, and that's fine, but I believe that the origin of that pain exists in them. And my response to that person's or that people's violence will affect their next action, you know?
Yeah.
Do they pull the gun and actually pull the trigger, or do they just pull the gun? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the difference between the first pulling of that gun and then actually pulling the trigger has this little moment of, what is my response to it? Is it a place of fear, or is it a place of compassion? Is it a place of humility? I'm not surrendering and being like, oh, okay, shoot me, you know? But it's like, I see you suffering. Even if I never say those words, it's a response to violence that comes from a place of compassion.
Yeah.
That was a very long-winded way of saying that, what I just said.
Yeah, well, I mean, you just, you're bringing lots of images to my mind. And I don't know, for some reason, I've had this image of me being in a situation where someone just totally has me under their control, pulls a gun on me or something, or is threatening violence to me. And I've had this, I don't know if it would really happen, but this image of me meeting it with compassion, just saying to the person, is this really what you want?
Yeah.
Is it really, and just, you know, you're in charge, you could kill me right now, or,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I do think that's, it's not like I wouldn't personally give up on tactics. I'm open to tactics to, you know, in response to violence, but if, you know, the world is more powerful than me, it's very easy for me to be in a situation where I have no control over what's going to happen, and I would hope I'd meet it with compassion, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think this could turn out better if we aren't violent in the next few moments for both of us, you know? But
it's good to rehearse these things. Even, you know, I would wish that I would wish that no one has to deal with this, but that's not the reality.
Yeah.
That's not the reality. That's far from the reality. And so, you know, also legislation, you know, there's to be an action around making a difference with our voice, with our vote, you know, making phone calls, writing letters, showing up, supporting changes to be made for how our police operate in this country. You know, how guns are thought of, and NRA's got a lot of money, so we're up against, you know, a pretty big beast there, a lot of deep pockets.
Yeah.
But if we just say, well, it's too big and it's just a violent world, then that feels like a defeatist attitude.
Okay.
You know, and so I want to be both strategic but also realistic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I pray that I never get held to gunpoint, and that may be the case for me as a light-skinned woman, but I know that's not the case for most people of color in this country. Will not have that luxury of not ever having violence acted upon them, whether it's a police or not. It doesn't even matter, you know. And so I think it's important, like I was saying, to know how to extend protection and be active in our legislation and solidarity to change the culture of violence that we live in. It is a culture of violence. It has to change, and it must. And it is, but again, there's an urgency there. That's very, very key to the next generations coming. What we expose our children to, I think, is a huge low-hanging fruit of how we can affect change in the culture of violence. And that's something as simple as, you know, what are you exposing them to? TV, movies, video game-wise. What is the language you're using? Is it filled with profanities or anger and rage? Those are also could be considered violent. You know, so, you know, starting where we can affect change and keeping sight of the work that needs to be done on the other levels.
Yeah.
It's a both and. Yeah. Just talking about the world today.
Just talking about the world. Well, we have cruised past our 1 hour mark pretty well. Is there anything else you would like to say to the universe before we wrap up?
Ooh,
our
to the
episode?
Universe.
Yes.
Well, it looks like there's a couple of people on that I'm seeing.
Oh, we could check to see if they were.
On the side there.
Indeed, one relative, I believe, of yours.
Okay. All right.
Very nice little comments, Kelly Grace and from Rosanna. No questions have been posted.
Okay.
So I'll
close with two things. One would be to give thanks to all my relatives and all my relations. So I mentioned some of my lineage, and I just want to recognize that all of those who came before me are what's helped me sit here now with you. And so I'm just giving credit where credit is due, and I acknowledge all of those who came ahead of you to bring you to this moment. So give thanks there. And I'd also like to say the Mandala Center for Change logo, which is pretty cool, mandalaforchange.com.
Mm-hmm.
The little plug is change the world and have a good time doing it. And so that is, you know, what I'll leave you with and just
that's
leave myself with. And
change the world.
And have a good time doing it. Not just fun, but a good time. A good time can be hard work.
Yeah.
But, you know, have a good time. To me, that includes take care of yourself, take care of each other, find ways to nourish along the way. So that we're having, you and I and we, the collective, are having a good time changing the world. We, you know, we have the power to shape and change, and we're stronger together. So let's do it.
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
All right. Now, everyone out there.
Go change the world.
You do your part.
And have a good time doing it.
Yeah. And you come back and you can be a guest on the show.
Yeah.
Tell us, you know.
That's great. Thank you for holding space and your good questions. And
thank you. Do you ever want to be a guest host?
Like, I would love to.
You can host, and so you could be interviewed by me or Jale.
Yeah.
You can request.
Maybe next time I'll interview Matt. Has anyone interviewed you?
Not on my show.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there you have it.
Yeah, that could be your warm-up.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
All right, so cue the disco music to end the show.
Do the hustle.
All right, and thank you for watching. Yeah, we'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye, people.
Hi, Mama Almi. That's, for you. Okay. That is an upload high definition. Post.
Cool. That was fun.
That was fun. Man.